attention, O foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a plea against his people, and he enters into trial with Israel. O my Lord, what have I done to you, or how have I wearied you? Answer me, for I brought you up from the land of Egypt, from the place of slavery I released you, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. With what shall I come before the Lord, and bow before God most high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with myriad streams of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my crime, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? Have you been told, O man, what is good, and what the Lord requires of you, only to do the right, and to love goodness, and to walk humbly with your God? The Lord of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To the upright I will show the saving power of God.
To the upright I will show the saving power of God.
Gather my faithful ones before me, those who have made covenant with me by sacrifice, and the heavens proclaim his justice, for God himself is the judge.
To the upright I will show the saving power of God.
Not for your sacrifices do I rebuke you, for your burnt offerings are before me always. I take from your house no bullock, no goats out of your fold.
To the upright I will show the saving power of God.
Why do you recite my statutes and profess my covenant with your mouth, though you hate discipline and cast my words behind you?
To the upright I will show the saving power of God.
When you do these things, shall I be deaf to it? Or do you think that I am like yourself? I will correct you by dwelling them up before your eyes. He that offers praise as a sacrifice glorifies me. And to him that goes the right way, I will show the salvation of God.
To the upright I will show the saving power of God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Reading from the Gospel according to
Matthew. Glory to you, Lord.
Some of the scribes and Pharisees said to Jesus, "Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you." He said to them in reply, "An evil and unfaithful generation seeks a sign, but no sign will be given, except the sign of Jonah the prophet. Just as Jonah was in the belly of the whale 3 days and three nights, so will the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth 3 days and three nights. At the judgment, the men of Nineveh will arise with this generation and condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and there is something greater than Jonah here. At the judgment, the Queen of the South will arise with this generation and condemn it, because she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon, and there's something greater than Solomon here." The Gospel of the Lord. Jesus isn't being very nice to these scribes and Pharisees, not at all. He is condemning them very clearly and using these comparisons with the Ninevites and with this whole city of sinners and this judgment that will come, and saying that the Ninevites, of course, are far better people than these scribes and the Pharisees is very insulting. And to say that the Queen of the South will rise in this generation and condemn it, because there's something, because you came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon, and that there was something greater than Solomon here. So what is greater than Solomon, and what is greater than the prophet Jonah, is God himself, Jesus, who is in their presence, who ought to instill in them a desire for repentance, a conversion, this metanoia, a change of mind, a whole change of course in their lives. But there is no changing that's taking place. Rather, they seek to go after him, and they will do their best to undermine him, to shut him up, and of course, to kill him. That will become their mission. Their hearts have been hardened. They are cold, and they will become ruthless. They want the status quo. They want to hang on to their power, to their influence, and Jesus is going to really challenge that at every level. And they just can't let go. Others will be called to penance, like this great city, Nineveh, which took 3 days to get there. And could you imagine going down to Philadelphia and everyone just sitting in sackcloth and ash doing penance for their sins? No. We can't begin to imagine. And that an entire city will do just that in order to stay the hand of a vengeful God who is going to seek to punish them. But their hearts were changed. And it was through penance that they expressed their sorrow for their sins and sought to change their lives. Penance is very important in the life of every Christian. Venerable Fulton says this very, very beautiful, wonderful understanding of what penance is. He says, deep sorrow does not come because one has violated a law, but only if one knows he has broken off the relationship with divine love. But there is yet another element required for regeneration, the element of repentance and reparation. Repentance is a rather dry-eyed affair. Tears flow in sorrow, but sweat pours out in repentance. It is not enough to tell God we are sorry and then forget all about it. And I think this is what people want to do, isn't it? Isn't that kind of our culture? We just want to say, I'm sorry, no problem, whatever, and then just sort of move on. It is not enough to tell God we are sorry and then forget all about it. If we broke a neighbor's window, we would not only apologize, but also would go to the trouble of putting in a new pane. Since all sin disturbs the equilibrium and balance of justice and love, there must be a restoration involving toil and effort. To see why this must be, suppose that every time a person did wrong, he was told to drive a nail into the wall of his living room. And every time he was forgiven, he was told to pull it out. The holes would still remain after the forgiveness. Thus, every sin after being forgiven leaves holes or wounds in our human nature. And the filling up of these holes is done by penance. A thief who steals a watch can be forgiven for the theft, but only if he returns the watch. That's a great analogy, isn't it, for sin and the need to do penance. And we do that certainly coming to Mass and offering our prayers and lighting candles and having our novenas to Lady the Miraculous Medal, praying the rosaries, all of these things, these acts of penance that help to really bring about healing, to close up those holes, if you will, that are broken human nature. Today we celebrate the feast of St. Camillus, who died, I think, in the year 1614. And here was a Roman soldier in the Chieti region of Abruzzo, and actually from the region that the Italian side of the town is from. And he really struggled with gambling, and he had his conversion, become a priest, and he would establish hospitals. He would establish a religious order that would really help to bring about healing for people through the hospitals and so forth. Caring for the poor, caring for people who really needed help in so many different ways. And we're called to do the same. Maybe not, of course, establish hospitals and so forth, but to bring about healing in the lives of others. And that means that we have to live the faith first. We ask the Lord for that grace today. May his peace be with you. As we begin this debate, we turn to our Heavenly Father with complete confidence that he will hear and answer these prayers.
For the Church, may the Lord help us grow in unity as we seek to embody Christ in the world. Let us pray to the Lord.
people of Ukraine, for all those whose lives have been torn apart by war, violence, and poverty. For all those in need, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we trust all of our needs, your providential care, and ask it out of your hands. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Blessed be your God, all creation, for your goodness we have received and grown all of you, fruit of the earth, the work of human hands, come for us to our God.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed be your God, all creation, for your goodness we have received and while we are all of you. Through the divine and work of human acts, come on our spiritual
work. Blessed be God forever.
Pray, brothers and sisters, my sacrifice of yours, and make yourself to God, the Lord, and Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice in your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good.
Receive, O Lord, the offerings of your people, and grant that we who celebrate your Son's work of boundless charity, made by the example of Blessed Camillus, be confirmed in love of you and our neighbor, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is too right and just, for we need our salvation always and everywhere to give thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, Christ our Lord. Present the festival of St. Nicholas, you do, bid your church rejoice. So too, you strengthen her by example of his holy life, teach her by his words and preaching, and keep her safe and answer to his prayers. And so, the company of angels and saints, we sing a hymn of their praise, as without end, we obey.
Holy, 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 Lord God. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Glory to the Lord, the fountain of all things. If only therefore these gifts we pray, that we may gather spirit and mind unto you, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time of his betrayal and his willingly to his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks for it, gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks to you and fellows worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one body of the Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity. Together with Francis, our Pope, and Nelson, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep
Greater love has no one than to lay down his life for his friends.
Now we pray, O Lord, that we who are renewed by these sacred mysteries may follow the example of us, Camillus, who honored you with tireless devotion and by surpassing charity was of service to your people, in Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Glory be
to God. And with your spirit.
And the mighty God bless you, Father, and Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Lord, give peace to us.
Thanks be to God.
So you might be our angel.
And bless the battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all the evil spirits, from right above.